Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all the nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that you have prepared a great salvation. And when we finally see Jesus, when we see Jesus for all he is, we are ready to meet you. We know that we've found the most important thing, that the searching has ended and the enjoyment and the growth and the wonder increases from day to day. And Lord, we come this evening to contemplate and to think of what it means that the Creator of the whole universe would send his Son, truly God and truly man, God with skin on, and come to earth. And Lord, help us to see deeper into all that means tonight. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let me read to you the first five verses of the Gospel according to John. And this is what it says. The word, by the way, has a capital W in this. It's not just word, it's the word. This is how it reads. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it.
I want to take you back to the very beginning, to creation and the fall.
Out there, is there anybody out there
there, God's mighty plan of redemption began to bring back and redeem his people. We're going to hear now from the scriptures, and our first reading is from Matthew 1, 18 to 23. I should have written down who's reading them, but they know.
Matthew 1, 18 to 23. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through his prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us.
Let's stand and sing, "Joy to the world, the Lord has come." Next reading is Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 2.
After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him."
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favour rests."
Mary's boy child, Jesus Christ.
Long time ago in Bethlehem, so the Holy Bible say, Mary's boy child, Jesus Christ, was born on Christmas Day. Hark now, hear the angels sing, a new King born today. And man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. Trumpets sound and angels sing, listen to what they say, that man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. While shepherds watch their flock by night, they see a bright new shining star. They hear a choir sing, the music seemed to come from afar. Now Joseph and his wife Mary came to Bethlehem that night. They found no place to bear her child, not a single room was in sight. Hark thou, hear the angels sing, a new King born today. And man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. Trumpets sound and angels sing, listen to what they say, that man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. By and by they find a little nook in a stable all forlorn, and in a manger cold and dark, Mary's little boy was born. Long time ago in Bethlehem, so the Holy Bible say, Mary's boy child, Jesus Christ, was born on Christmas Day. Hark now, hear the angels sing, a new King born today. And man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day. Trumpets sound and angels sing, listen to what they say, that man will forevermore because of Christmas Day.
We often found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. This is the word of the Lord.
Hark, the herald angels sing. And I think we should probably stand for that too.
Thank you. Luke 2:4-7. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them.
Remain seated as we sing Silent Night, Holy Night.
And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has been mindful of the humble estate of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed."
You see, Mary realised that this night was special. This announcement was life-changing. This night eclipsed everything else. And in a sense, that's what we've done today by coming here today. And I'm very thankful to those of you who have put aside time to come here, those of you who have made sure that this has happened, that this has been a year full of distractions. This has been a year of all sorts of things that have taken our mind off what life is all about. And we're here tonight to remember that there's something bigger than COVID. There's something bigger than all the problems that we have. There's something that is so much brighter than that, so much more important than that, and we want to remember that and let that rise above everything else. And so we're going to sing together. This is usually a song that we get a soloist to sing. It's got some high notes, it's got some hard notes, Imagine if you were asked to do this song, it's O Holy Night. Imagine if you were asked to do this by yourself, it wouldn't happen. For most of you, it wouldn't happen, would it? I'm trying to see who it could happen for. I won't say. But let's do it together. Let's all be soloists and let's sing this to our Lord. Let's have one audience tonight, the audience of God Almighty, and we'll be the performers performing before Him. O Holy Night.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end."
"How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her.
I'm going to do the next song. It's actually a little message. Those of you who are here this morning will know this is the next passage after what we looked at this morning, the second angelic visitation. And I want to talk a little bit before we look at this about interruptions. Interruptions come at all sorts of time, don't they? And for many people, Christmas is an interruption. For us who are here today, it's a reminder of what life is all about. I don't know if you've noticed, but the newspapers seem to have largely ignored Christmas this year. I usually look at a few Christmas papers just to see what they're saying. Whereas the Melbourne Cup often will build up for weeks, there's virtually nothing about Christmas. And I imagine for many, as I've said, that Christmas is a bit of an unhelpful interruption. Interruptions are so often a plague. They often steal away rather than give. And they always seem to come at the worst possible times. I don't know if any of you have had those religious people knock on your doors and try and sell you books and get you into their way of thinking. I'm one of those people who actually like it when they turn up. I like to talk with them. But even for me as a minister, they often turn up at the worst possible times. And it's often difficult to focus. There was a recent study by Brit O'Connell and David Frolich of Hewlett-Packard Labs in England, and they found that on average, their managers were being interrupted just over four times every hour. The average duration of an interruption was 2 minutes and 11 seconds, and approximately 10 minutes in every hour was being spent engaged in an interruption. And in just over 55% of those cases, the recipient returned to their original activity. I'd also like to point out that's an old study. That was before email really took off and iPhones. One of the worst interruptions, of course, is advertising. Sometimes we watch gripping TV and it's punctuated by advertising. It's difficult to watch a gripping documentary or a gripping movie that's both incisive and probing when every 12 minutes one is interrupted by dancing rabbits singing about toilet paper. I've got an iPhone. I quite like iPhones. Like most people, I probably like them more than I should. I love all the things that you can do on the iPhone. There's one thing that really annoys me about the iPhone. Does anyone know what that is? Anyone have a guess? One thing that I don't like about the iPhone.
Siri.
No, Siri is one. Now, the thing that most annoys me about the iPhone is when somebody actually uses it as a telephone. Isn't that crazy that the iPhone was supposed to be a phone? That was what it was all about. But when somebody rings, it's like, oh, I'm in the middle of something. Interruptions, the bane of our lives. Today, the degradation, someone said, this is from Lewis Mumford, today the degradation of the inner life is symbolised by the fact that the only place sacred from interruption is the private toilet. Now, not all interruptions are bad. In 1942, the US had been fighting World War II for nearly a year, and Dr. Vincent Senna was having dinner that night in the crowded Coconut Grove restaurant and bar. He was paged because one of his patients had gone into labour. Dr. Senna rushed to the hospital in time to deliver the baby and save his life. After he left, for still unknown reasons, the Coconut Grove burst into flames, and over 490 people died in the smoke and the flames. That interruption that night that ruined his evening also saved his life. And so we're going to look at another lady who was interrupted. She was interrupted by an angel. She was shaken up by what the angel said, yet it was the best news ever. Gabriel, the angel Gabriel, came to Galilee. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. And Gabriel is God's supreme messenger who brought a great, glorious, and crucial announcement from heaven. In the book of Daniel, chapter 9, for example, this same Gabriel brings many great messages. And in Daniel, he delivered an all-important pronouncement to Daniel regarding the rest of redemptive history and unfolding in the incredible vision of 70 weeks. And now the message of Christ's forthcoming birth, which was so critically important, and Gabriel again announced it. God sends Gabriel to Nazareth in Galilee to bring this announcement. And it's interesting that not only does Gabriel announce it to a young woman and not to the high priest or the religious leaders, but Gabriel announces it in Galilee. Galilee was not the center of Jewish culture and religion. In fact, it tended to be more Gentile in its orientation, with a significant non-Jewish population surrounding the area. It was called Galilee of the Gentiles. And so when God made the direct and formal announcement of the coming of his son, the promised Jewish Messiah and King, it came to a part of Israel that was intersected by many non-Jews. Preacher John MacArthur paraphrases God's intention this way: "My son will come to a family from Nazareth in Galilee because he will be the saviour not only of all Jews who believe, but also of believers from every tribe, tongue, and nation, even Australians." And so Gabriel came to Mary, a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph. And the angel said, "Greetings, you are highly favoured, the Lord is with you." And how did Mary respond at this announcement? Notice what she didn't do. She didn't run around everywhere saying, "I've been touched by an angel, the angels have come to me, how great I must be." She didn't write a book of her experience and go on a current affair. We read in God's word that she was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. And you see this in the scriptures, when people truly encounter God, it's a holy moment. It's a sacred moment. It's a moment of fear and trembling. It's a moment of inadequacy when the holy comes to the unholy. I remember when the disciple Peter, Jesus told him to put his net on the other side of the boat. And Peter had already been tried every side, backside, front side, left side, upside, downside, nothing. And when Jesus said, "Why don't you try here?" he said, "Come on." And then when he did what Jesus said, the nets almost broke because there were so many fish. And he realized a little bit about who this Jesus was. And his first words to Jesus was, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." As we come into contact with the holiness of God, we're humbled. And so she pondered the message. And she may have asked herself over and over again, "Why would God ever want to choose me, an unworthy sinner, to be the recipient of his amazing grace? Why would the Lord single out me for such a privilege?" To her, it was staggering. Nothing on earth could have prepared her for such a breathtaking opening announcement. She was shaken by the angel. After all, the angel that spoke to her was, as one writer put it, a sky strider, an inhabitant of holy heaven whose face caught fire from standing near to God, whose glory darkened all the common world in which she lived. The angel's appearance did not shake Mary as much as the nature of his words. She was greatly troubled at his words, we're told. She knew she was a sinner who did not deserve to receive God's grace. And that's why later she praised God and called him God, my Saviour. Mary is not, as some people teach, sinless. She needed a Saviour just as we do. And so the angel reassured her by saying that God had singled her out, not because she had earned it, but God was acting especially favourably towards her. "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have got special favour from God." And she worried about God singling her out before, but she was worried at the initial moment, she had reason to worry now. In verse 31, because the angel said to her, "You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save the people from their sins. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom will never end." Mary said, "How will this be, since I'm a virgin? How does this happen?" And at this point, we'd probably all, if we were here this morning, we'd all jump back, because we remember what happened to Zechariah when he said, "How can this possibly be?" But God understands the difference between a fresh, inquiring mind and a faithfully, highly educated saint who should have known better. Mary was trying to nut this stuff out, and God was gracious with her. It was a reasonable question, and the angel turns from rules to the ruler, and he grounds the truth of his answer not in creation but in the Creator. And the angel said this: "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." And then Mary was reminded that her sister Elizabeth was about to have a child, her cousin, her relative. And the angel said this: nothing is impossible with God. And so by the promise of God, the old and barren woman Elizabeth conceived. We saw that this morning. But that diminishes next to this, that the promise of God, by his promise, a virgin will conceive. And so how did Mary respond to this interruption, this intrusion even? I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Alien, where the alien impregnates a man whose stomach explodes as he gives birth to an alien. That's not the right kind of picture to have here, so erase that from your mind. She knew the Father, because the child will be called the Son of the God. This was the Messiah that the Jewish people had been waiting for so long. She could say yes to God because she saw her life not as the all in all, but as a small part of the big picture. And the big picture had come to her and said, "I want to reveal myself through you." Yes, she was frightened, but her fear dissipated against the backdrop of the great privilege of knowing her God and that her God was in control. And so she responds with loving trust. It's a response we should all have towards God. "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." And the angel left her. How easy it is, isn't it, to be so wrapped up in the mundane that we miss the big picture. In December 1903, after many attempts, the Wright brothers were successful in getting their flying machine off the ground. And thrilled at this, they telegraphed this message to their sister Catherine. And they said, "We have actually flown 120 feet. We'll be home for Christmas." Catherine hurried to the editor of the local newspaper and showed him the message. He glanced at it and said, "How nice. The boys will be home for Christmas." Totally missing the big news that man had flown. Do you know today that many big churches don't have Christmas services? They're finding that people don't turn up anymore. Church is too much of an interruption to their Christmas, and it suits everyone just to get on with the feasting and the festivities. I remember one of my first years when I was the minister at Warburton Presbyterian Church, and I think we had just a dozen people show up on Christmas Day. And I remember saying to one of the elders, I said, "Even if it's just me and you that comes here on Christmas Day, we're going to keep doing this." Because this is the reason that we celebrate Christmas. Jesus was an interruption, but what an interruption. And so I want to ask you, will you let Jesus interrupt your Christmas? Will you let Jesus interrupt your life? What about us? Have we allowed Jesus to interrupt our lives? Have we said to him, "I am your servant, use me for your glory"? What about you? Will the story of Jesus be an annoying interruption for you over this Christmas period? Or will it be the very heart of Christmas? And I believe for many of you that your very presence here is a testimony to the fact that you want to hold on to and dig deeper into the true Christian message. It is also a sign that you know that the principal thing about Christmas is the guest of honour, the one whose name takes up the first 6 letters of Christmas. And like Mary, you treasure these things deep down in your heart. Jesus is not an interruption. Everything else becomes an interruption when we know who Jesus is. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, when we think of you as the creator of the whole universe, of everything, how amazing it is that you would consider us. And not just consider us from on high as little specks, the minuscule thought that we deserve, that you yourself would become a speck. You would become one of us in the person of Jesus Christ, truly God and truly man. That Jesus, the bridge between man and God, between people and God, has enabled us to come into your presence to know you. We thank you that Jesus has shown us what God is like, and he's made it possible for us to know God. And Lord, we pray that you would interrupt our lives, because there's nothing else more important than this. In Jesus' name, amen. We've been looking a lot at angels today, so let's sing about angels. Angels from the realms of glory.
Now revokes the sin. O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the world and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. That God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art. How great thou
art. May God bless you and your families as you celebrate Christ and meet together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.